Good morning, everyone. It's just coming up on 10 o'clock, so I'd like to get this event started by welcoming all of you to one of the first events for this week's Celebrate Learning Week. This is the Teaching and Learning Innovation panel. My name is Simon Bates. I'm Associate Provost Teaching and Learning on the Vancouver campus. And along with my colleague, Heather Behringer, Associate Provost for Learning Services on the Okanagan campus, we'll both be hosting and moderating this session. So in starting today, I'd like to recognize that this is an event across both campuses, and our campuses are situated on traditional territories. In the case of the Vancouver campus, that's the traditional territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. And this morning, I'm joining you from my home, situated on the traditional lands of the Katsi First Nation and the Kwantlen First Nation. And I welcome all of you from the land and the territories and the locations that you're joining this meeting today. I'd also like to start with a recognition that although we're celebrating learning this week, there's a section of our community this week that is mourning the loss of one of our faculty colleagues this week. I want to acknowledge and pay respects and sympathy to friends, family, and colleagues of Sonika Elliott, the sociology professor from UBC Vancouver, whose death was tragically reported this past weekend. And with that, I will hand over to my colleague, Heather Behringer.
Thanks so much for that welcome, Simon. As Simon said, my name is Heather Behringer. I am the Chief Librarian and the Associate Provost for Learning Services here at UBC Okanagan. And I am honored to join you today from the beautiful traditional, ancestral, and unceded territories of the Stilkitch Okanagan peoples. Across both campuses, but I'm going to speak for UBC Okanagan, we've been engaged in curricular innovation for as long as I can remember, as long as I've been here and well before, specifically in the case of the Vancouver campus. We are celebrating teaching and learning in all of its presentations here, and I am thrilled today to be with you to celebrate and showcase some of the recipients of our Alt 2040 and the TLEF in Vancouver projects. And I will not belabor it. I will move us on quickly so that we can get to the real meat of this presentation. I'll pass it back to you, Simon.
Thank you. So just briefly to review the agenda slide, you will probably have heard this event is being recorded and it will be shared on CTLT's YouTube channel, but comments via the chat will not be recorded. The format today is we have short presentations from four panel participants. You can feel free to post your questions in the chat and we'll address them during the Q&A session at the end of the four presentations. This event also has closed captions. You can see them by clicking on the CC button in the meeting controls at the bottom of the screen. And there's also staff available to help with any technical difficulties that you may have. I'm keeping my fingers crossed for a strong connection for everyone who's presenting and participating. But if you do have technical difficulties, then staff are on hand to assist with that as best they can. So if we could move to the next slide, please. Okay, so the format today, as I said, is we'll have short presentations from four teaching innovators across both of our campuses. I'll introduce them one at a time as we go. They will have just a few minutes to present some highlights of their projects. These are projects funded either by the Alt 2040 Fund on the Okanagan campus and the Teaching and Learning Enhancement Fund on the Vancouver campus. And then we'll have an opportunity for questions that Heather will moderate at the end. So moving us on, it's my pleasure to introduce the first of our panel presentations from Siobhan McPhee, Associate Professor of Teaching in the Faculty of Arts in UBC Vancouver. Over to you, Siobhan.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks, Simon, and thanks, Heather. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Celebrate Learning Week. Thanks to everyone for organizing this panel. I've been very privileged to have quite a number of projects funded by both TLEFs and SOTL projects over the years, which have enabled me to really innovate and explore different means of teaching and learning in my positions teaching within the Vantage One program and then in my teaching in the Department of Geography. And they've explored different elements, but it's all been focused around what I term blended pedagogy or a blended approach to teaching and learning. So I just wanted to spend my time this morning talking to you about what I mean by blended pedagogy, or if you like, the approach that I take. I think first and foremost is that there's often an understanding that when we talk about blended pedagogy or blended learning, that it automatically means the inclusion of educational technologies or emerging media. For me, that is a bonus, or if you like, that's the availability of innovative technology and is a way of enhancing the blended pedagogy. But the essence of blended pedagogy for me is a means to facilitate, to enable active learning. So that is first and foremost what I think about when I think about blended pedagogy. I guess the way I teach is the way that I wish I'd been taught in school. I was a terrible passive learner. I got incredibly bored in my classes. I hated rote memorization. Exams stressed me out because I didn't see the point of them. I didn't like that teachers didn't want me to ask questions. So I took one in my, you know, in my teaching, I keep that in mind and try and provide students, I don't always get it right, but provide students with a space where that I can address those things that I found most challenging. If you like, it's what the late Sir Ken Robinson talks about as the problematic traditional university approach to the delivery of teaching and learning, which is like we're just, if some of you have seen his animation video of we're producing more factory workers. I find it quite ironic because in the university, we talk about the fact that we need to not just create workers, we need to create thinkers. But essentially for the last 300 years, what we've been doing is replicating ourselves or creating people to fill certain positions. So adopting a more blended pedagogy for me, as I said, means embracing a new paradigm of teaching and learning, one that fosters critical thinking and specifically soft skills, as well as of course, the transmission of knowledge. So students are increasingly, as we're aware, entering a very precarious employment world where the nature of jobs is continuously changing. And if you talk to people who run co-op and various others across UBC, you'll know that employers are more and more looking for those thinking outside the box skills from our students rather than what they can regurgitate in terms of information. And as I said, for me, this sense of active learning and empowering the students is it is about giving them the tools to be able to direct their own learning. And educational technologies and emerging media is a means of doing this, but it is certainly just a tool. And it's a very problematic approach if we start seeing technology as neutral and as the answer to all our woes in terms of addressing some of these, the need for more critical, more engaged learners and therefore graduates moving outside of the university. So new and ever increasing technological solutions are being marketed or promoted to educators as a means to their teaching being more relevant in changing times. And we can see that even what happened in the last 14 months or so at UBC, with a whole host of new tools being offered to us, and then some of those even being removed very shortly afterwards because of some of the very problematic issues that emerged. So thinking about technology in a very critical way. So I suppose that's my premise of what I've been doing. I'll speak briefly about some of the projects that I've specifically been funded by the TLEFs that I've received. So initially, the initial TLEFs were used to fund augmented reality projects or immersive media. So I created an app with a small Vancouver startup company that, so in geography, field trips are a huge part of our teaching and learning approach. So this enabled students to go downtown at their own pace and engage in the history and the present reality of the downtown east side and the history of the Canadian Pacific Railway, the political economy of Vancouver. And then the second step with the more recent TLEF that I've been working on is to create more blended courses within the Department of Geography. So taking an approach where it's some of it is, this is pre-pandemic, it just worked out in my favor then, that some is delivered online and some face-to-face. But the idea again is that students take on a responsibility for their own learning. And this is done through the use of interactive and emerging technologies. Working with, I'm just going to briefly share my screen. Can someone tell me how much time I have left?
I think if we could ask you just to wrap up in the next minute or so, Siobhan, so we've got plenty of time for questions.
Okay, thanks. That's perfect then. So I'll just briefly share this screen. This is what I've been working on for the last year. This is a first year course in geography using Tapestry, which is a tool developed by Stephen Barnes and various others at UBC. And the idea is the students create engage in these modules, and then we meet and have the lectures. So just to give you a sense of what these look like, the students complete some very, I can share the link in just in the interest of time, complete some of these activities. And then when they join the lecture, they will have covered a lot of the information that we will then it'll be more of a discussion and more of a conversation rather than me just speaking. So I'll stop there and I'm happy to follow up with any questions during the question and answer time. And I've shared the link in the chat.
Great. Thank you, Siobhan. Really appreciate the comments on both the affordances and limitations or challenges around use of educational technology. I think that's something that a lot of us have felt over the past 15 months or so. Moving on, we hop over to the Okanagan campus. Raymond Lawrence is a professor in computer science in the Irving K. Barber Faculty of Science at UBCO. Over to you, Raymond.
Thank you, everyone. I appreciate being here. My project was basically creating virtual labs and a help desk. So my area of research and teaching is computer science. And our motivation is we were seeing decreasing engagement in our labs, as you also see in person courses as well. The reason is for many reasons. Many students, it doesn't fit in their schedule. They have a lot of other things going on. And often, unless you force them to attend the labs with marks or some other reason, they're not really engaging with the material that you want. So our goal with this project is try to make virtual labs and have the technology to help them out. Now, it seems kind of quaint right now when this project was proposed before COVID, where everybody was doing virtual labs and virtual lectures. But the results that we take away from this, I think it's really important because we all are excited to come back in person, but we also all know that it won't exactly be the same, and nor should it. We've went through this experience, and hopefully that's encouraged us to look at everything that we are doing in terms of our teaching and trying to make it better. And that's definitely the perspective I'm taking, and our department and many others are taking that viewpoint. So some interesting results that we got from this. And once again, it was kind of strange because we were thrown into it. It really didn't become a research anymore. It became necessity like everybody else, which went virtual. but just some feedback we're getting from the students. I'm in computer science. I love technology. You want to deploy technology, but the students don't want all the different types of technology. They're much happier to do things that everyone else is using. So even though we investigated various software for interacting with users, they much preferred to be using the UBC standard tools, whether that was Zoom or Collaborate Ultra. So unless you have really strong reasons for introducing new technologies, they don't necessarily make the pedagogy better. So that was really interesting from our perspective. The other thing is, even when we go in person, flexibility is going to still be the key. Our goal with this particular project was to eliminate the labs overall. So that wasn't just a technology aspect, there was curriculum as well. We had challenges with scheduling, as we did with challenges with attendance. And what we ended up doing is we have eliminated the labs for one of the courses, and at least one more is coming. And the more we can do, the better. Because even when we're in person, if we can be flexible and allow students to engage with the material on their own time, whether that's using technology or not, that's really where we want to be at. And so that's really where the focus is continuing to be in the work that we're doing right now. Now, ongoing, what we're trying to do is build some of that technology. What became obvious while we were forced into our COVID teaching is, although we have a lot of tools out there, they don't all work together. It's hard to, as an individual instructor, to integrate them into your courses. So for even the ones that we have eliminated the in-person labs for, the technology is still not ideal. And there's two motivations for improving the technology. One is obviously student success and engagement. And so we want to introduce technologies that will help that. And the other one, I'll be honest, when I have a class of 200 students, I don't want to mark 200 assignments or 200 midterm exams. So one of the things we're investigating is how we can use technology to mark things that you wouldn't expect. So it's not just marking multiple choice answers, but marking diagrams, marking things that are higher order skills is really important. So that's something we're spending time doing. And I'd be definitely interested in following up with anybody who also has those interests. We're trying to look at integrating into Canvas, because as I said, students really appreciate the integration. They don't want separate tools. So if anyone has experience with that, including CTLT and other people, I'd be happy to have further discussions with you. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you for having me here.
Great. Thank you for those comments. Again, a number of things you said really resonated with me. One thing that I'd pull out is when you said the future is going to look different for teaching and learning after COVID. And I think part of what we'll all be engaged in over the next year or so is figuring out what those differences will look like as we transition back to campus. Time to explore that and other things a little bit later in the questions. For now, we stay at UBCO. Isha Ravindran, Associate Professor of Teaching in English and Cultural Studies in the Faculty of Creative and Critical Studies. Over to you, Isha.
Thanks, Simon. And thanks, Heather and Michelle, for organizing this event. It's a pleasure to be sharing this platform with my colleagues from both campuses. So I'm leading an old 2040 funded project in developing a certificate and a minor in communications and rhetoric. And the acronym that we've selected is CORE. I'm working with a team of four members: Jordan Stauch, Mari Laughlin, Anita Chowdhury, and our RA, Anne Clary. And we're supported by an exemplary advisory committee of 16 members from different faculties, schools, and units on campus. So I'll focus mainly on this particular project. What is our objective? Our TLEF funded project supports the development of a 15-credit certificate in communications and rhetoric, which will be piloted in winter 2021, and a 30-credit minor, which we plan to pilot in winter 2023. So as you can see from the encapsulated information on the displayed poster, the certificate is open to students from almost all faculties and schools and campus, as well as will be the minor, and both will include interdisciplinary content and perspectives. And that was our main focus. to encourage conversations between different disciplines and also to encourage adaptive transfer between the disciplines. So how did we develop this program? Our Dean Bryce Traister had already initiated discussions about program development in communications and rhetoric, and it appears in the faculty five-year plan, but it required, and I use a term from rhetoric here, keros, that is grabbing the opportune moment to bring all the elements together for this project to operationalize. So we were cognizant of altered student academic needs, provincial reports with emphasis on communication skills, the restructuring of the BA and BSc at the UBCO campus, and of course, the availability of ALT 2040 funding to make this program a reality. So the next question is, why communications and rhetoric? We believe that these two knowledge strands and practices are intrinsically bound together. And an understanding of the strategies of rhetoric, that is the use of persuasion, is required to communicate impactfully. How is this program different and significant to student learning? So there are three strands embedded within our program design. Cross-disciplinary perspectives, so that students develop the ability for broader understandings of the use of rhetoric across the disciplines, and in expert and lay contexts, an expanded repertoire of communication skills, so that it is not focused only on academic writing, but on communication in diverse multimodal contexts that facilitates student navigation and effective communication of information across different genres, different platforms, and disciplines. And thirdly, the transferability of these skills to professional contexts so that employability and professional development are enhanced. So what is the structure of the certificate? You saw that in the previous slide that was displayed. Through discussions with the advisory committee, we have identified four thematic clusters: the self, the individual and others, the community, and the media, with specific learning outcomes. Courses are classified in these clusters, and students must complete one course from each cluster and a mandatory interdisciplinary capstone. We piloted three courses last year, Core 203, 204, and 205, Communication of the Sciences, the Humanities, and the Social Sciences, respectively, and we will be offering at least one core designated course in each cluster next year and plan to develop additional courses in the future. So a final point, students can include two courses from their programs to double count towards a certificate. Through conversations with all the departments at UBCO, we've identified courses that align with the learning outcomes of the four thematic clusters to potentially double count. So that's a brief encapsulation of the program structure and content. And I welcome queries about processes related to the application and implementation of this project during the discussion session. Thank you.
Thanks, Aisha. It sounds like a terrific interdisciplinary opportunity for students. Fourthly, last but by no means least, Larry Leung, lecturer and interprofessional education co-lead from the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences on the Vancouver campus. Larry, over to you.
Thank you, Simon, for the introduction and for inviting me here today. Before we dive right into the project, I want to start off with this quote just to give us a little bit of a jolt this morning, because I think it does elicit a lot of strong emotions for people. So I wanted to go over this quote with everyone. The settler moves to innocence are those strategies or positionings that attempt to relieve the settler of feelings of guilt or responsibility without giving up land or power or privilege, without having to change much at all. This the concept of a settler moves to innocence was articulated by Tuck and Yang in 2012. And I think it serves as a very powerful reminder of the complacency that can occur in Western academic institutions. And it's so incredibly important for all of us as Canadian citizens to engage in the collective responsibility, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous, to participate in meaningful contributions to this area. So our project is called Uproot, a community-based approach to decolonizing and indigenizing the pharmacy education. Myself, I'm a pharmacist, and obviously I work in the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. We call the shortened form of the project, we call it Uproot, because we're really trying to do two things. Number one, we are working to uproot the deep-seated colonial structures that exist in our teaching and learning practices. And two, at the same time, ultimately, we want our students to uproot their own values, their own views, their assumptions, and their biases about Indigenous health and cultural safety, with the ultimate goal, of course, of creating practitioners that are culturally safe and competent. And so one important element I really want to share up front here with everyone here today is, obviously, I am a non-Indigenous educator, and I'm operating in this space. And I understand the power and the privilege that I have getting to work in this really privileged space here. This work is built on years of partnership building, and I'm really happy to be here representing the entire team here today. So the purpose of the project is really to build, strengthen, and scaffold Indigenous curricula. And we're doing that in two ways. Number one, building a core pharmacy course on Indigenous health and wellness. And number two, revamping an elective that we've been running since 2012 into one that uses a blended model of Indigenous community-based learning and classroom teaching. The entire curriculum is overseen by an Indigenous advisory committee comprised of Indigenous experts and partners and community members, as well as self-identified Indigenous students. And really what we're aiming for is having the meaningful participation of our partners to ensure the way that we go about building curriculum, the way that we deliver curriculum, and the way that we evaluate this curriculum really respects Indigenous knowledge, values, and practices. And so one of the key elements of this TLEF project is really the reciprocity with our partners. I've mentioned this already, that this has been built on probably 8 or 10 years of relationship building, which for myself and my colleague, Jason, who's serving as a lead on this project with me, really prioritize as sort of our most important element. So one of the key things that we ask ourselves in this type of TLEF is typically when we're building curriculum, and you heard me talk a lot about curriculum building, that benefits the academic institution, that benefits our students, and I'll admit it, it'll benefit me in terms of sort of my career progression. And so really, as part of this project, we really wanted to flip the script on that and really prioritize what's important to our partners. And so one of the key elements of this is to build community-based projects really that are based on Indigenous identified needs and priorities. And so that's sort of what we're looking to build on first before we start the curriculum building for our students. And so again, the community-based projects will serve as an important opportunity for ongoing reciprocity and for maintaining the partnerships that we value a lot in our faculty. I wanted to just keep my introduction nice and short and invite any questions during the Q&A period. But that's just a little bit about our project. We also have a poster later on as part of the TLEF showcase. I'm happy to go over details during that part of the session as well. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you for those presentations. Heather, I'll hand over to you for the Q&A. We've got, I think, 79 people in the session, not counting the panelists and ourselves. So I think we'll have plenty of input for a great discussion.
Thanks so much for that, Simon. And I'll remind everyone that you can ask your question by typing it into the chat, and I will do my very best to moderate. Sort of start off perhaps the panelists with a starter question. We'll get in there light. And maybe we'll use the same order for our panelists that we did for their presentations, because I'm a librarian and principles of organizational management are pretty important to me. So I will maybe start with you then, Siobhan, and ask what motivated you to take on this project, and then ask each of the panelists to start us off with that.
Thanks, Heather. What motivated me is, as I was outlining, is really the same motivation that I have to taking a blended pedagogy, which is I wanted to be an educator that I desperately craved when I was in school and in university. I think that it's actually incredibly challenging to be within an academic institution and be an innovator. It seems to be a contradiction, which I find astounding. And so I'm very grateful to CTLT and TLEF and for, you know, enabling those of us who want to be innovators and creators within the confines of the traditional academic institution to do so. And what has continued to build on your question, Heather, what has continued to push me is just the feedback and reflections I get back from my students. As I build more of these, as I provide more blended pedagogy, put more emphasis on the students, they thrive under this rather than shy away from it. I agree with some of the comments that, you know, they don't want to be overwhelmed with tools. That is very true, but they do want the independence. They've just never been really taught how that is. And so I think we're kind of starting from the ground up in that way. And I'll stop there to allow others to answer.
Raymond, can I pass that question to you and both to answer and maybe even build upon some of what Siobhan's put forward?
Sure, I really agree with what she said. I think educators were challenged to always do better. And so that's the first thing, the reason why I did this project. I want to keep doing better for the students so they have a better experience. And one way of doing that right now is being more flexible, being able to accommodate and developing your curriculum, your tools in order to do that. So I think that's really important. And honestly, the second part of it is I don't like marking, which most people don't. So if I can automate some of that and give them better learning experiences, that's a win-win.
Isha, can I ask if you want to build on that as well? No one loves marking.
No one loves marking. I totally agree, Raymond. And I think I agree with what both of you have said with regard to this responsibility that we carry with regard to making changes in the curriculum. And I think one of the reasons why we developed this program was in response to student needs, because students felt that they required, the focus has always been on academic writing, but academic writing is only one part of communication. And I think that's what we wanted to encourage, the ability to navigate multimodally using multimodality in different contexts and different platforms. And of course, the other thing was to encourage these conversations. We wanted to dismantle this wall that exists between, as C.P. Snow once said, two cultures. And we wanted to encourage these interdisciplinary conversations. And finally, of course, how would it be possible for students that learn specific skills in oral communication or academic writing to adaptively transfer that in different contexts, not just academically in different disciplines, but also professionally, also outside the academic context. And these, I think, were the main reasons that motivated the development of this particular project. Thanks, Heather.
Thanks, Asia. And Larry, is there anything you'd like to add to that and talk about your motivations?
Yeah, that's a great question about sort of our motivations for this project. I think when we look at Canada as a colonizing power and the history in Canada here with cultural genocide and the intergenerational trauma that has resulted in it, academic institutions are not safe from that. Academic institutions have a strong history of colonial-based education that's centered on assimilation and extraction of Indigenous peoples from their worldviews and their communities. And despite all of that, Indigenous communities in British Columbia and across Canada are thriving. And so I think one thing that really motivated us was the fact that there's an opportunity here to take a strength-based approach and a community-based approach to curriculum building. And so one thing to acknowledge is all of the decolonization, indigenization efforts that we all see across all of our campuses, for me, is a direct result of the strength and resiliency that is displayed by our Indigenous partners. and the non-Indigenous partners that they're working with. And so I think for our project, there was just an opportunity for, again, for us to take a strength-based approach to addressing the truth and reconciliation calls to action for health programs to integrate this type of learning. Again, not just for health programs, for all programming. And also just in response to, you know, even the last report in plain sight about systemic racism that exists in our healthcare system. I think there's a very, very important call to action for all of us to participate in that. So that's sort of what has motivated us with this TLEF project.
That's wonderful. That's really powerful too. We'll remind people, I'm going to prioritize questions that come in from the Q&A, but don't have any yet. So of course I have another question. Oh, I just got one. I'm going to read that first, but here's my other question first, which is to ask about the impact that your project or projects, I know some have done more than one, have had on your own teaching practice, and maybe talk a little bit about like what I learned from this project for myself, your own practice and student learning as well. I'll do the same thing and start with you, Siobhan.
Sorry, Heather, just to clarify, what did I learn from the project?
Yeah, what impact has the project had on your own teaching practice?
Okay. I think I'm actually, if it's okay, I'm going to also tie it in slightly with one of those first questions that came in, and because it speaks to that, which is, I think I, you know, I was trained in a way of teaching where we are seen as the experts and we transfer or transmit knowledge to our students. And what I've learned over the last 8 years at my time at UBC is often I'm still a learner myself, and always will be, even though I'm also an educator and I suppose an expert in a very small field. So I really have learned to take the feedback from my students. Yes, they don't always know what they need or what they want, but then again, I don't always know what they need or what they want. So I think it's a dialectical relationship. And I think that anything we build, by build, I don't mean literally build, you know, a tool or that, but I mean by building courses, interacting with students, is that it should really be taking on board reflection and comments from students. And that's certainly something that it's also taught me to be more empathetic, because I've always been very hard on myself, as in like motivated and challenged. And often students, not all students have the same approach to their learning. So it's about being open to different ways of engaging and learning.
I hope the other panelists here won't mind if I do pivot to the question that came in the chat. I am going to read it because for the recording, the chat is not recorded. So I'd like those watching the recording to be able to know what the question was. And here it is. Several times, the panelists mentioned that students did not like or want certain things. I'm all for listening to the needs and wants of our students, but I wonder how true it is that often students don't know what's good for them. That sounds old and crotchety, but this is true for many pedagogies that are well supported in the literature, such as spaced practice and more frequent assessments. If students are overloaded, maybe it means we're expecting them to take too many courses. I'd be really interested to hear, Raymond, maybe I'll pass it to you to start, your thoughts about that.
Yeah, this is an excellent question. And as I mentioned in my opening remarks, we really have to figure out as educators what this new normal is going to be. And that involves taking a lot of different data points. It involves the knowledge we have, our colleagues, other things that have worked in other universities and research, and the students as well. And there's not a perfect answer to this, but I think the key thing is to look critically and to look scientifically. It shouldn't be just opinions. You should be doing experiments and figuring out what works and what doesn't on your particular domain. And just because it worked in one place doesn't necessarily work in another. So there's a lot of flexibility that has to happen there. So there's, for the particular person asking the questions, I don't think there's a right answer. You can say in your course, this is the best way to do it. One thing I've learned in my own teaching practice, it's a very personal thing as well. And what works for one person may not work for another as well, depending on your personality and your delivery style. But I also believe that you can often sell many things. So if you're truly passionate about it and you know it's going to help, the students will buy in. You just have to be passionate and sell it to them and convince them.
I saw nodding heads. Aisha, is there something, can you add to that or present your opinion on that or thoughts?
I would love to add to that. And I totally support everything that you said, Ramon, because we often accuse the students of plagiarizing or cheating in the exams, and we find methods and means to police them. And I personally am totally against all of these systems. So I think this is an opportunity for self-reflection as well. Students may not always know what's good for them, because I often hear responses from students, online asking questions from other students, which is the easiest course. So that's not our objective. Our objective is to ensure that learning takes place. So when there are instances of plagiarism, my suggestion would be, how about engaging in self-reflection? How about trying to not accuse students of plagiarism, but find means so that we support students and so that they are not compelled to what they're taking. It may be because they're taking too many courses. It may be because the content is extremely difficult for them, whatever be the reason. I think it's a moment for self-reflection, and it's a moment to reflect on our own courses as well. Thanks for that excellent question.
Larry, you have, I noticed you unmuted, so you already
know. Yeah, I love the comments from my fellow panelists here. I think, Firas, I think that's a great question. I think where sometimes the challenges will come from is when programs standardize the way in which we teach across multiple courses. And what ends up happening is, our curriculum is evidence-based. I think a lot of us are, and the pedagogies that we implement are things that are very well supported by the literature. I think the challenge is when we do that across all the different courses, so that space practice, multiple assessments, multiple checkpoints, they appear in every single course. And then somehow we've kind of gone the other way now, where the pendulum has swung so far the other way, where we're implementing all of these great different pedagogies, but now it's looking very similar across courses. And I think Raymond had a great point, is that, sometimes those ways of teaching do not necessarily match the educator and what their strengths might be. And so, given for the example that I talked about, I think, for example, implementation of Indigenous pedagogies for learning is not just beneficial when we're teaching Indigenous content or cultural safety. In fact, many Indigenous pedagogies for teaching align with certain Western methodologies, and they are quite effective to utilize those across other types of teaching as well. So it's a great question.
Thanks so much for that. Another reminder, we would love to get more questions in the chat, but I have another that I thought maybe I'd go back to, which is a little bit around the projects itself, that themselves that you were working on, and maybe to ask you to put your mentorship or peer hat on and see if you have advice for others who might be considering engaging in these kinds of projects, applying for TLEF or ALT 2040, some of your thoughts on the process or advice on what people might think about in preparing to do that. Siobhan, I'll start with you.
Yeah, absolutely. Two comments. One would be dream big. Don't feel like you have to fit into a box. This is what the TLEFs, at least in my experience, are for. It is the ability to push the boundaries. And the second thing I would say is absolutely seek out the support that CTLT offers to go through the process. It's incredibly helpful, and they're pretty honest and will tell you if you're on the wrong path. And so, yeah, I would say that the support is there, and use it. And sorry, I said two comments. The third thing I would also say is, and anyone you speak to at CTLT through the process will tell you this, but if you're applying, bringing in the voices of students, whether it's through doing a survey with them or having them be a part of the application, is also very powerful, not only in the possibility of getting funding, but also in for your own experience in shaping the project.
Thanks, Raymond. Can I ask you the same question?
Yeah, I want to echo that the CTLT has been very supportive. Your other colleagues, I want to call out Michelle Lamberson on the Okanagan campus for being very helpful. If you've written grants before, I don't think those are as onerous as some research grants. So I really encourage you to do it. I guess my big thing is do it. Get out there, make a difference. That's really important. Not enough of us are trying to innovate on this. And it's great to see so many here. If you have any interest in doing it, do it. It helps the students, it helps your department, it helps the university.
Aisha, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, Raymond, I completely 100% agree with you. Just go out there and do it. That's what I would say as well. For us, what was really interesting was identifying the advisory committee and having these conversations. So we were more or less practicing what we wanted to actually implement through the program. So I think that's really important. Identifying what this project is going to be about, but also getting feedback from others on campus so that they contribute to your project. I think our project, even though we discussed it over a period of time, it all came together only during the final weeks. So I think it's important to just start working on it. One of the things, though, that I'd like to comment on is the actual implementation, because our program was completely new. So one of the things that I would like to say, if you're planning to work on a new program, expect the unexpected, expect a lot of paperwork, expect some frustrations along the way, but believe me, you get tremendous support from everyone on campus, especially enrollment services, every single person on campus. And so it finally works out well in the end. So identify a project and just begin the application for the next time the call is out.
Thanks so much, Aisha. We got a question direct for Larry. So I'm actually gonna put you on the spot a little bit, Larry, and ask this question. Can you speak to the depths or commitment needed to build relations with Indigenous community and scholars, to build relationships and center reciprocity in developing the curriculum? What type of legwork was needed, and what was maybe your personal aha moment in that process?
That's a fantastic question. I love that question. I love that that's sort of the line of thinking that some of our participants are thinking of. Yeah, I think I've spoken about it a lot, about sort of the partnerships and how it's taken us about 8 to 10 years to get to this point. I think one of the things that's important to recognize, and one thing that I've mentioned before, is you really should allow your partnerships to drive the work instead of allowing your academic work to drive what you do with your partners. I think oftentimes with even TLEF funding or other types of funding, we often go in with preconceived notions of what we think would be best. And I think it would be the metrics of success that we normally deem are important in an academic institution: getting grant money, publications, getting great learning for our students. And it's about sort of changing and shifting your mindset to really go in without a particular agenda and allowing your community partners to drive the decision-making process and to drive what projects should be done. And I think that's true for both working with Indigenous partners, but also other community partners. I think flipping the script there is so critically important in building a really strong foundation. And so, you know, for me, that kind of contributed to my personal aha moment. And this happened 8 years ago. I, you know, before going into community, I researched the community. I figured out, oh, diabetes is a thing that's happening in this community. It's very prevalent. So I came up with an entire program myself about how we could address this through education and some practice changes. And I had an elder pull me aside and just talk about how incredibly cold and colonial my process was, which was really not centered on that. And I share that because I'm happy to be vulnerable in sort of the mistakes that I've made in this process as a non-Indigenous person. And I think that was a really personal aha moment for me, is to understand that your partners understand their community, their own health, their own practice better than you can, even though you're from an academic institution. And so really, they're the experts in that area. And as such, we should treat them that way. And so that includes including them early on in the grant writing process. It includes ensuring that there are specific line items that are geared towards improving their capacity and education and whatever else they might need. So that's sort of some of the legwork that I think is just kind of go in with an open mind and have some open conversations around what that work might look like. I'm working in areas where I never thought I would work in. And I think that's really exciting.
Thanks so much for that, Larry. I'm going to channel speed dating here for one moment and try to do two questions in 3 minutes really quickly and put the panelists on the spot. I'm going to ask this one to you, Siobhan, because you've done multiple projects, I know. And there's a question about whether you could comment on the most effective methods you might have used to assess how effectively your projects enhance learning.
Yeah, I saw that question. That's a really good question. I think, as I already said, having continuous check-ins with students. So I run halfway through the course a survey with students, asking them their input on how they're finding the specific tool that I've designed to have them engage in active learning. And then I do a follow-up survey at the end of the course. And then I follow that with a focus group where I ask for more specific input from students. And I've done that in both my projects. And that has worked very well because you get the kind of broad quantitative view and then get specific input from students.
Great. Thank you. Raymond, there's a key question about whether you have managed to find any applications that support automated marking.
There's no perfect tools. I encourage you, Canvas does a lot. If you're in math and science, we have a WebWorks integration, which can do some things as well, but it's still open on some work there. So if other people are interested in that, I'd be happy to talk to you about working on more stuff.
And I'm going to sneak in one last one, eating into Simon's closing remarks a little bit here, I'm afraid, but I think it's important. And Aisha, maybe I'll pass this to you. I'm going to shorten it a little bit, but to say, do you perceive notions of teaching collaboration projects broadening post-COVID-19? For example, structural changes to courses, programs, other collaborations that meet interdisciplinary or interprofessional learning goals, and repeated teaching work of teachers working on making similar goals, like inclusive learning, for example.
Absolutely, that is our intention as well. And we've just started with a certificate. We've garnered feedback from students as well as faculties and schools on campus. But as we develop the minor, this is definitely what we're looking forward to developing. Collaborations with faculties from other campuses to include that interdisciplinary and cross-disciplinary element in course structure as well as course delivery.
Thanks so much for entertaining my speed dating analogy at the end. I really appreciate that. And we are out of time for our Q&A, so I will pass this over to you, Simon, for some closing remarks.
Great, thank you. So I want to start my closing remarks with thanks to all the presenters and all the participants, because the questions that were coming in, these are great questions, and to have to try and answer them in 30 seconds or so really doesn't do justice to the depth and complexity of the questions. So I wanted to thank everyone for their participation. Maybe just offer four quick comments in summing up. I was frantically taking notes as the Q&A was progressing. And the first one is just around the diversity of the projects that these funds support. We shared four with you in this session. You'll have an opportunity after this to look at more in the virtual poster session. But even in those four, there's a huge breadth of pedagogy and pedagogical and curricular innovations that were being talked about. And I'm thankful for the way that as an institution, the funds, the ALT Fund and the TLEF really demonstrates this commitment to advancing education and its enhancement across our campuses. And so I think one of the really gratifying things about these enhancement funds is they really support a broad range of of projects, both in a disciplinary sense, but also in a pedagogical sense. Another thing that really came out for me was teaching as a community effort. And I mean community in the broadest sense there. Every single one of the presentations that were highlighted, the projects that were highlighted, were partnerships of some form through peers, colleagues, students, central support units like CTL, CTLT, communities outside of the university. And one of the panelists said, we just want to keep being able to do better. I think we could all subscribe to that, but in doing that, we recognize that this takes time. Many of these projects have had very, very long runways. I think it was Larry who said 8 years of building these collaborations with community. So it takes time, it takes resources, and it takes support. And again, I think there's tremendous community strength, and again, community in the broadest sense, in helping provide that support. Third thing was I saw real connections to institutional priorities, educational renewal, program development, interdisciplinary initiatives and opportunities, Indigenous commitments, and our responsibilities to those as we build and enhance programs and curricula. And then the final thing I'll offer is I think Celebrate Learning Week has always been, for me anyway, a moment to try and reflect, to press pause and sort of take a bit of a wider view around teaching, my own teaching, and across the institution. And I hope you'll all have some time at least this week to engage in that reflection. But a number of times we heard how really important that is at the moment, given what we've been through over the last 15 months. I think we really are, as an institution, at a bit of an inflection point for teaching and learning with many different futures ahead of us. And no easy answers, because our teaching, as we all know, it's complex, it's messy, it doesn't always transfer neatly from a research paper to our own particular context. So I really do get the sense that this is an opportunity for us to reflect on what the future could be and what it should be. So I think that brings us very close to time. I believe, Michelle, am I handing back to you for some comments on the showcase that's coming next